morning, First Baptist Church. Peace and blessings to each and every one of you. I am so glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning and welcome you to this time, to this space for worship. If this is your first time joining us, then I encourage you to reach out. Please reach out because we want to invite you and welcome you to First Baptist Church. So please leave a comment on YouTube, reach out through the Facebook page, connect with us on our website because we want to connect with you. If this is not your first time, then I welcome you back and encourage you to make sure that you know you are encouraged, that you know you are welcome, invited to exercise your gifts. All right, to use your gifts to strengthen who we are, make us more complete and more whole as a local body that we can contribute to the larger body and to all creation all the more because of your gifts. So I encourage you in that way. Beloved, as we join together today, we give thanks to God for Isaac Penrod, who has joined us for special music. Beloved, we are going to be blessed. I'm telling you, blessed through his selection. Thank you, Isaac, for joining us for this time of worship. Now, dear friends, let's join together in prayer. Dear God, precious God, good and loving God, shepherding God, we give you thanks for guiding us to this time where we can be fed, where we can be filled, where we can be nourished and be restored. God, bless us. Bless this time that we would recognize your goodness and mercy, not just during this time of worship, but all the days of our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, dear friends, let's join together as we lift a joyful noise unto the Lord. Thank you. a shepherd. We're talking about the shepherd today, beloved. At this time, I encourage you to greet one another with the peace of Christ. You know, peace of Christ be with you. Peace of Christ. You know, share some gesture with the people that you're sharing space with. You might use the peace emoji. You might use the peace symbol with the in there. You might share it in a special way, but you want to share the peace of Christ, all right? Somebody virtually share with the people that you're sharing space with right now. Remind somebody that God loves them. Remind somebody that you love them. And share the peace in a special way. Amen. Amen. Now let's join together, going to the Lord in prayer. Oh God, our souls are weary. We hear too easily the clamor of the world. We witness the terror and trauma all around us. We long for good days, oh God. Good days, safer days, simpler days, where we may feel cherished and protected. In this spirit, we have come to this time of worship, seeking your peace and hope. The psalmist wrote of green pastures and refreshing springs of water, places of rest, offerings quietness and comfort flood our thirsting souls. What we would give for such places in the heart. Amidst all that is difficult, and we know that you know the difficulties endured in these days, there is one who leads us to these places where, when we have gathered strength and healing, we might be prepared to go forth in confidence to serve once again. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, knows our name and our needs. He listens for our cries and responds in love. We can have great assurance in this. Today we offer up the names and situations of illness, mourning, stress, and concern which touch our lives and souls. We breathe our heart's desire for healing and restoration. May God's abundant love flood over them and flood over us until we are more than filled. God, be with all these dear ones in their situations and their needs. And God, be with us, strengthening us, restoring us, healing us, challenging us to witness to the good news of salvation that we know through Jesus the Christ. God, we lift these prayers unto you, trusting your Spirit intercedes on our behalf. Now we join together, praying the prayer taught to us by your Son, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, the glory, forever. Amen.
By some I'm told, I can carry my on my own 2 feet to stand. Well, it may fuel my pride, but I know that they lied, so I lay it down. So I lay it down. So I lay it down. every time that I say I should do it my way, I must lay it down. There is one who will say every time that I fail, you have gone too far this time. What good are you now? You've let them all down. I must lay it down. So I lay it down. So I lay it down. The accuser seems right, but I know that he lied, so I lay it down. With all that has been done for us, why do we still fail to trust? Why do we hold our own hands? It's time to let it all go. It's time to give up and know all of these things are in his hands. On a hill stands a tree with a man in my place. My sin to erase. Death won't hold me down. He has delivered us now. Because he laid it down. So I lay it down. So I lay. Every time that I say I should do it my way, when the abuser seems right, but I know that he lied. All my sin, all my pride, it's for these that he died. Since he laid it down, I can't lay. So I lay
down. What I tell you, what I tell you, beloved, Isaac blessed man from the playing, like your musicianship, your vocals, the message, to lay a swallow my pride, lay it down, recognize the enemy's lies, lay it down, recognize the freedom, the salvation that we receive because Jesus chose to lay it down. Because he laid it down, we can lay it down. I hear you. Come on, Isaac, thank you. Such a gift, such a gift, such a perfect song, a selection for our scripture reading today. Thank you so much. Beloved, our scripture reading today comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. John 10, 11 through 18. Listen now for the word of the Lord. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the good shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I received this command from my Father. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of God's word. Lay it down. He says it 5 times in these few verses. Refers to himself laying it down, laying his life down. And there are some important theological, doctrinal, you know, assertions and you know, concepts in here. Some things that push us away from harmful ideas connected with substitutionary atonement. I'm talking about, there's some things in here. But look, this is what we're going to look at today. Lay it down. A lesson in legitimate leadership. Lay it down. A lesson in legitimate leadership. We've talked before about the ways in which shepherd is connected with, is language that directs hearers, audiences toward leaders, governors, those with influence, kings, rulers, those with influence over the masses, the ways in which we might have talked about before, that pastor is connected with the word, the word for shepherd. And so it has to do with leadership, and especially the text tells us, if we were to read on, we would see that this is during the Feast of Dedication, or what we might recognize as Hanukkah, when the people remember the rededication of the temple, when leadership, the integrity of leadership was restored, and it meant something once again, because the temple, the people of Israel were back on their feet. They could worship once more. And so the idea of what real leadership is in the back, what real leadership really is in the back of people's minds in this context in which this text is written, because they're in the Feast of Dedication right now. And so Jesus is very intentional, very precise with his choice of language here, talking about the shepherd. He is talking about leadership, giving us some lessons in legitimate leadership. Revealing 3 things that we're going to look at, because we can't look at all the lessons. Come on now. I mean, we could, we should. But we're just going to look at 3 right now. A legitimate leader puts people first. A legitimate leader is relational. And a legitimate leader fosters unity. Okay, we're talking about lessons in legitimate leadership here. First, a legitimate and admirable leader puts people first. People before any and everything else. People before prestige, or people before one's own reputation. People before personal agenda. People before profits. People before everything. Admirable leadership is all about the people, securing their needs, protecting their safety, and preserving their livelihoods, the livelihoods of those who are affected by one's leadership. Puts people first to the point of laying down their own lives if need be. See, Jesus sets up this shepherd hired hand dichotomy, revealing the difference between the two, showing the ways in which some leaders find themselves in positions of leadership out of personal reasons, selfish goals, self-oriented desires, while some are there truly in order to serve, in order to be about the flock. Some people there just to make, you know, a hired hand. I just need to make a couple of dollars. But the shepherd is about that flock. And there's one person that has come to my mind when thinking about this hired hand example, this hired hand versus shepherd example, J. Bruce Ismay. J. Bruce Ismay, some of y'all might recognize that name, but you'll remember the person that received a lot of criticism because of their leadership or lack thereof in light of the sinking of the RMS Titanic. Ismay, first, in overseeing the construction of the ship, gave the green light for the ship to be made only to hold the minimum amount of lifeboats in order to compete with competitor ship liners. The minimum amount of lifeboats. Keep that in your mind, all right? Going on that notorious voyage, he went to the captains and encouraged them to increase the speed, legend tells it, so that again, he could compete. He's thinking about his own reputation. He's thinking about his own popularity, his own agenda. He wants them to speed up to be able to keep up or outshine his competitors. And then we know what happens. They strike the iceberg. And while this ship is going down, Ismay, instead of trying to help other passengers, he secures his own place on one of the few lifeboats. Now, look, I'm not trying to just beat up on this dude. I'm not trying to just, it's not like that. But his own wife and children expressed their disappointment in his leadership. Because in securing his own spot, he overlooked his family. This is the hired hand style of leadership, the self-serving, the profit prioritizing, the lily-livered leadership that Jesus warns about. But also present on this ship were captains, executives, businessmen, leaders, who while in the midst of chaos, they found every woman and child that they could find and packed those lifeboats to their maximum occupancy, even losing their own lives in the process. That is the example of what it means to put people, other people, first. This is an example of admirable leadership, of what it is to follow the Good Shepherd. And look at this, beloved. J. Bruce Ismay has my birthday, or I have his birthday. We share the same birth date, which reminds me of my need to keep my vision, my sight focused on the Good Shepherd as I go in and search out leaders worthy of my admiration, worthy of my following. And even as I try to be an admirable leader myself, that I might follow the Good Shepherd and put people first. So what we see right here, admirable leaders, leaders with integrity, put people first, but also admirable leaders look to be in relationship with those whom they lead. We might take this for granted, but when we think about it, how often do we encounter leaders that want to distance themselves from those who follow? That want to be held in such high esteem, lifted with such great reverence, placed on a high pedestal, and adored beyond measure. So often the leader wants to make themselves into some type of miraculous wizard. Think about the example of leadership in a book or film that many of us might be familiar with, The Wizard of Oz. Now, we have some examples of leadership in right in this film. There's four people that are on this journey to find some things that they are desperately in need of. They're looking for heart. They're looking for brains. They're looking for courage. And they're looking for a way back home. And so they set out on this journey to find the wizard. And when they find the wizard, this wizard is terrifying. This wizard is like, goodness gracious, like, not too many people even get to see the wizard. They are lucky enough to go see the wizard, and the wizard is terrifying. The wizard has all of the smoke and all of the lightning and all the thunder, all everything that's so distancing for the followers. But then what do they find out? All the while, look, spoiler alert, hello. Somebody, it's just a regular dude behind a curtain. And that's some leadership. What is that? You putting up this facade, you putting up all of this stuff to keep people at a distance. That's nothing. There's nothing real about that leadership. But look, where's the real and true source of leadership found in this tale? Dorothy. Dorothy, the one that's with everybody the whole time, the one that's in relationship, that's established and strengthening relationship with everybody involved this whole time. And because she has relationship, she's able to point out the ways in which the people already possess what they are in search of. You already have heart. You already have courage. You already have brains, but dig this, even through the relationship with the brother that's been behind the curtain the whole time, because she's prioritizing relationships, she finds a way home for herself. You feel me? You feel me on that, right? This is it. This is real leadership. Admirable leadership not only welcomes or opens itself up to relationship, but pursues it. Jesus says, "My sheep know me, and I know my sheep." And through this, we are able to recognize that authentic connection, relationship, is key in being a legitimate leader. Legitimate leadership is willing to lay down the ego and the false pretenses and the flashing lights and the fog machines and all of the extra stuff. Legitimate leadership lays down whatever it is that denies possibility for real relationship, that the leader can know the followers and the followers can know the leader. So where are we, beloved? You with me? Are you with me? I know you're with me. Admirable leaders prioritize people, pursue relationship, and value the importance of being an agent of unity. Recognize the importance of fostering unity, of bringing people together. Once again, we have many examples of leaders that do the opposite. In subtle ways, place wedges between portions of the population and different groups of people. Subtly, might use certain phrases, might nod their cap in certain direction, but then we got people that just blatantly pick a side or pick a group or pick that direction toward the aisle, pick that end of the spectrum, and then get to work rallying the people and inciting rage and placing stones in the hand of one group to be thrown at the other. You might have some people that, some names that's coming to mind, some faces, some images that are coming to mind. The ways in which certain leaders might add to, contribute to, stir up the heightening of division. Jesus chose an alternate route. Jesus chose a different path, a better way for establishing leadership, identifying himself as the good shepherd who has sheep, in separate folds, but brings them together to create one flock. There's a lot of mystery around. There's a lot of surmising. It's a lot of sermons, and then it's a lot of just brainstorming and reflecting on what all that means, what all that can mean. But often it's the other. It's the exact other. It's the people that can't get together. It's the people that can't be brought together. It's the people that can't get it right. It's the exact other. But Jesus brings them together to be one flock. Jesus did not intend to contribute to division or separating people. He didn't find his divine directive to be that of segregation or apartheid, but that all might be one as he and the Father are one. Come on, one last time. We gotta go once again to the world of literature, the world of cinematics. And we remember the example of leadership provided by that group that is portrayed in the film, Remember the Titans. Coach Boone and Coach Yost, this story is so amazing. And Remember the Titans, we encounter a story, a true story of a football team's journey through the ups and downs of the federal integration mandate in this season of 1971. With a black head coach and a white assistant coach, the racially mixed team bumped heads at every turn, and there's some brutal blows being thrown by the groups. It's some hard going, some rough going. The coaches also have their moments of conflict. And this is like dramatically understating it, all right? The Disney film dramatically under-presents like the serious conflict that's going on. But they come to a point, these coaches, Coach Yost and Coach Boone, they come to a point of recognizing and appreciating the fact that if they are going to have a successful season, then this team is gonna have to function as one. Gonna have to be some unity. They are gonna have to make themselves agents of unity. And so they commit to it. And it's still some rough patches that have to be worked out. But because of their example, they prove that their leadership is not only admirable but contagious, because the team captains, black and white, catch drift of their leadership and join in themselves, being agents of unity, and then their leadership is followed by the team, that they are able to be one. And they go crazy this season, like mad successful. Why? But it doesn't even stop there, beloved. Look, what started with the coaches, recognizing that they had to be agents of unity. They have to foster togetherness, oneness. It transmitted on to the captains and then on to the team. But look, this team proved itself to be the thermostat and not the thermometer, because of their leadership, the whole town was able to mend some gaps, to find some unity, to cross some divides that were previously impossible. This is it. This is it. This is exactly what the Good Shepherd lifts up as legitimate leadership. For in laying down his own pride and prestige, did not find equality with God something to be used for his own advantage, for his own glorification, but humbled himself to become one with humanity, that humanity might become one together and might find reconciliation among itself and among its creator. This is the Good Shepherd. This is legitimate leadership, beloved. That there is a lesson on legitimate leadership that we find in our Good Shepherd, who did what? Who laid it down, who laid it down. And as we lay it down, we find life, we find love, we find joy, we find completion. Lay it down. Again, I'm believing even during virtual worship that God's love might be known, might be made real in your life, in our lives. And so I encourage, if you feel called, if you are led, if you are moved and want to know more about this good shepherd that we're talking about, if you want to be connected, if you want to join Community of Faith in First Baptist Church, look, the doors of the church are never closed. The doors of the church are never closed during this time of pandemic when we might not have been coming to the building. Come on, the church, The church has remained open. The church has remained at work. And so we open our arms. The doors are never closed. You are welcome to join us. You want to become a member? You want to establish a relationship with Jesus the Christ? Let us know. In the comments, on Facebook, on the church website, let us know. Let us know. Doors are always open. Dear friends, at this time, we have the opportunity to worship through giving. And we might have noticed the order of worship being slightly different, changing in certain ways, and the offering being toward the end. And the offering being toward the end is special, that we are able to give as we are growing closer to the end of service and, you know, thinking about leaving this space or this time and going into the world, going on with our lives. The way in which this giving right now foreshadows the continued giving in our lives, the continued worship that we engage in as we go along. And so we think about that even as we give right now, supporting the ministry of First Baptist Church. And I do thank you. I thank you because, like I said, the church has been going strong in ministry. There are different ways for us to give as we do so. We can give through the mail, sending it to the church address with attention to the treasurer. This way, each gift and donation is treated with much care and confidentiality. Another way to give is online, going to the church website, following the prompts there, being able to give online. And if you do so, please share your information there, just so that our treasurer is able to be responsible with the stewardship of the church, respecting the gifts that you share there. Once again, thank you. Thank you for supporting the ministry of First Baptist Church, and we pray God's blessing to be on this offering, that we are able to be faithful moving forward, responding to the call extended over the life of this church. Amen. Amen. Beloved, few quick announcements. Once again, thank you, Isaac Penrod. Thank you for that special music selection. Thank you so much. Blessed us to do that. Beloved, today is the last day, all right? Today, the 25th, the last day to share your treat, your goodie requests with the church office. So please send those in. Submit those, please, but also your hymn request for our hymn sing coming up next Sunday. Lori wants to know what songs you want to sing, what hymns you want to join together in. Look, it's not too late. You have today to submit it, all right? And so if you didn't submit one for the first one, and you got a special hymn that you want to join together with your church family, submit that. All right, if there are different ones you want to hear from the first one, just submit that. Kind of through your hymn submissions, we learn more about each other. And it's cool. It's a cool way to strengthen our bonds with one another through the hymn request. So please submit those. Also, continue to respond to the surveys, all right? We have received some responses, and thank you for filling out those surveys. But we need more, okay? We need more surveys received back to us, so go ahead and do it. You know, if you have mixed feelings, if you're hesitant, all of that, we want to hear all of that because that's informing us our decisions as we move forward. And we don't function with just one person. I'm not the church. The board is not the church. We need everybody. So please respond to those surveys. Again, today, business meeting. At 11 a.m., we join together for church business meeting. So please do join together for that because, once again, we need everybody's input. We want to make sure everybody is aware of the things that are going on in the life of the church, and to receive feedback, all right? So please join in for that. Also, look at the bulletin. Look at the messenger, okay? Because there's a lot going on in the life of the church, and we don't want anybody to miss out, all right? Now, dear friends, as we move from this time unto the next, may we remain united by the Spirit that ties our hearts together. May we be emboldened and empowered by Jesus the Christ. And may we cherish and share the amazing and radical love of God. May the peace of Christ be with you.
The King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. On his shoulders.